So, in these days, especially post WTO, post the agreement on agriculture, which India is also a party to, a number of new ways of looking at things has to come. I remember nearly 20 years ago when I went to Israel, I found that the Agriculture Research Organization had a budget out of which 87.5% was covered by contracts with farmers. It was entirely demand-driven. 12.5% was, you know, perhaps for their staff and running expenses and all that. There was hardly any blue sky research, no fundamental research. Practically all research was solution research, you know, finding solutions to problems posed by the farmer, funded by the farmer. Now, I'm not suggesting that overnight we should shift to that sort of thing, but then we have to start traveling in that direction. So has the extension system, so have the banks, so have the insurance system, so has the meteorological department. Even till today, it continues to be a scientific department. It puts out what it can and hopes that people will use it. It does not generate the kind of specified output which the farmer desires. Now, for instance, recently those who have been following the developments would have seen that in Cyclone Hudhud, which hit Visakhapatnam a couple of weeks ago, the very fact that a forecast was available 1 week in advance and it could more or less precisely pinpoint where the cyclone would strike had tremendous value, and it had incalculable kind of preventive value in the hands of the system. So the IMD is beginning to redeem itself, because I think it is beginning to catch up with contemporary technology and import it into giving a better forecast to the community. Such things have to be done by the other systems also, so that instead of continuing to produce only agricultural commodities, we transit to the production of products. Now, all of you know that in Paris market, for instance, a mango is not what the farmer thinks a mango is. A mango is a product with a certain shape, certain color, certain size, certain weight, etc. What you produce as a farmer may be totally different. And in these days of good agricultural practices gap, some 360 of them around the world, I'm told in India we've brought them down to some manageable 90 or something. But even in the most forward agricultural areas of the country, like say West Godavari or in Haryana, I don't think many farmers are aware of exactly what all this is and how the failure to abide by one of those practices will affect the performance of their commodity in the market. Now, unless we are able to carry this message to the farmer and make them do what the market wants, I don't think we'll be able to really change the present situation very much. And for instance, as I said, we keep saying there is a danger of food insecurity, therefore we should produce more. And in years where we produce more because we don't export and we cannot export because of our inability to stand up in the market and various other reasons, in the years of surplus, we are actually left with the dilemma of what to do with our surpluses, and they rot in our godowns. Now, obviously, we've got to come to terms with these situations, and simultaneously, about 40 million hectares, I was in the department dealing with wasteland a long time ago, I remember, at least are known to be what Dr. Swaminathan used to call not wastelands, but wasted lands, because nobody is paying attention to them. On the other hand, agriculture intensity can grow much, much more, we know that. Irrigation projects are lying incomplete, and I know that the subsidies we give for fertilizer and food in this country, for 5 years, if you withhold that subsidy, that much of amount is exactly enough to complete all the incomplete irrigation projects in the country. No, what is your priority? That is, it is time to stop and think where you want to put your money. In other words, this linear and incremental approach towards agriculture, doing more than what we did in the past or doing it better, is not good enough. We've got to learn to do things differently. Otherwise, we are not going to be able to make a dent in this impasse situation. So, I have one suggestion. I've been sort of canvassing this wherever I speak. Now, for instance, why cannot we think in Government of India at the national level, a cabinet committee on agriculture and rural development? After all, agriculture means so many ministries. Dr. Siddiq will know, for instance, the ICAR, the Department of Agriculture and Cooperation, the Department of Animal Husbandry and Fishery, the Food Ministry, the Commerce Ministry, the Finance Ministry, the Civil Supplies, Consumer Ministry, Forests, all these have to sit together if the farmer has to get some wholesome advice. And they've got to learn to sit together and scan the environment, look for threats and opportunities, capture, acquire information, add value, and send it to the right destination. After all, there is no such thing as information for cotton. Is it cotton in Warangal or cotton in Prakasham of Andhra? Or is it potatoes in UP or potatoes in West Bengal? I mean, every crop is not, you must know in which region, for what crop, which section of the farmer are you looking for to give advice. So if we have a cabinet subcommittee like that, and if it is serviced by, say, an agency like MANAGE, and if at the state level you also have the samitis which were set up by World Bank assistance, if they are also given professional competence, and at the district level we have in India what are called ATMAS, the Agriculture Technology Management Associations. Now there is a huge amount of fund available with every state under the newly introduced Rashtriya Krishi Vigyan Yojana. Now that money is largely either being unused or used for somewhat questionable purposes, primarily because there is no planning support for preparation of projects for that money. Now if these samitis and ATMAS use the money and available under this new program for funding it, otherwise at least, I remember a story of Alexander the Great. He went around the world and he, after conquering the world, I believe he came back and reported to Diogenes, his guru, and I believe he said, I've conquered the world thanks to your education. Now tell me what I can give you in return. I believe Diogenes said, Alexander, you're standing in the way of the sun coming to me, please move out. So that was all that he wanted Alexander to give him. So similarly, if we cannot do anything new and different and useful for the farmer, the least government can do and all of us can do is to get out of his way. At least let's not stand in his way. You know, like for instance, preventing him from going to the export market, or preventing fertilizer from being imported, or not giving him, you know, enough opportunity to store his produce after harvest. Now, you see, at least the restrictions currently in force which are preventing the farmer from accessing inputs and from reaching the markets, the minimum we can do is to think of dismantling that disabling structure so that he'll have the freedom to do what he wants. Now, I'm sure this glittering assembly of brilliant minds from across the world, already familiar with the conditions in many parts of the developing world, will in these few days that you spend here address these issues with a sense of urgency and purpose and give us some advice which hopefully will inform our strategies in the future. Thank you very much.